Baldwin.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker, and it's a pleasure to follow the Honourable Member for Wansbeck and to speak in this debate, welcoming the measures outlined in Her Majesty's gracious speech. And I do want to put on record, Madam Deputy Speaker, my thanks to everyone here, everyone in West Worcestershire, everyone across the land who has helped us get through such a difficult year. It has been a truly testing time, and it is wonderful at this moment that we can look forward to seeing an end in sight, and thank you to everyone who's worked so hard to get us here. And I think last week in the local election results, we really saw across the land support for so many Conservative candidates. And I think in the Queen's speech as well, we saw that we have a government here nationally that is one which really listens to what people want, pledges to deliver what people want, and then gets on with the task of delivering that. And I think the measures in the Queen's speech really cover a wide range of those pledges, and the job is now delivering in terms of those pledges. And I want to cover three disparate topics in today's debate, all related to a brighter future for the next generation. And the first is to do with further education in my constituency in West Worcestershire, and specifically the situation with Malvern Hills College, which was taken over in a merger by Warwickshire College back in, I think it was 2016. And unfortunately, during the last year, Warwickshire College have announced that they're going to close the site at Malvern, and they're going to start delivering the courses elsewhere, sometimes as much as 40 miles away. And I just wanted to say how much I back the local initiative to take over Malvern Hills College with a community-backed offer. It's something where I think with the lifetime skills guarantee, for example, we could use the college as a way to deliver some of those courses and that important training that we're going to need for our flexible economy. And I know the board of Warwickshire College is meeting next week, and I would just urge them to engage very seriously with this community bid. Malvern really wants to keep this college in our community. It's been there for over 100 years. It performs an incredibly important function. Now is surely not the time, Madam Deputy Speaker, to be closing that college. The second topic I want to talk about is the important commitment that we made to the world's poorest in our manifesto. And, you know, the whips know my views on this subject. They know that I am sad that we are breaking our promise to the very poorest in the world. But I do want to welcome the announcement that we heard today in terms of a plan for girls' education and the leadership that the UK government is showing to making sure that every child in the world can get 12 years of quality education. Surely there is nothing better that we could do for our world to make sure that every child, wherever they're born in this world, is able to have an education. It will make our world so much more prosperous, so much healthier, so much safer if we do that. It will tackle so many of the issues that we are facing in this country, where it was alluded to by the member for Gainsborough, so many desperate people are fleeing parts of the world. If they can get a good education where they are born, then surely this is the way forward in terms of a better world. So I'm welcoming the leadership that the UK government is showing on this issue, co-hosting with Kenya in July the replenishment of the Global Partnership for Education. Now, they're asking for a $5 billion replenishment over 5 years. And I hope that with the UK's, albeit reduced, amount in terms of UK aid, that we will be able to contribute very, very significantly to that. We're asking for 600 million of that 5 billion over 5 years from the UK government. Then the third rather disparate topic that I wanted to touch on, Madam Deputy Speaker, about a brighter future for the next generation is just to play the role that I'm afraid I played in the budget debates of a bit of a Cassandra, in terms of the bond markets. And as someone who traded the bond markets back as long ago as, well, I don't even like to mention how long ago it was, but long time ago when we had bear markets in bonds, the bond markets can turn on a dime, Madam Deputy Speaker. I think with the amount of fiscal stimulus we have in this country, the amount of monetary stimulus that there is quite a strong risk that we might spark inflation. We saw inflation in America in the statistics that came out this week. We saw the way the markets react to it. We are running quite a large risk in terms of our deficit with the potential for interest rates only to go one way from here, Madam Deputy Speaker, and that's upwards. And that could really damage the brighter future for the next generation. So I just urge those who are looking at the leading indicators in terms of our economy, and urge the Chancellor as he thinks about some of the fiscal choices that he's going to make, that often a stitch in time saves nine in terms of fiscal decisions, and that it to ensure a brighter future for everyone and for future generations, I do want to see us bring our deficit back into a manageable and one which gives bond markets confidence that the UK gilt market is one of the best places in the world to invest. Thank you.